the Holy Gospel according to Matthew, 13th chapter. Jesus put before the crowds another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed that someone took and sowed in his field. It is the smallest of all the seeds, but when it has grown, it is the greatest of shrubs and becomes a tree, that the birds in the air come and make nests in its branches. Tell them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed in with 3 measures of flour, until all of it was leavened. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which someone found and hid. Then in his joy he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. Finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and caught fish of every kind. When it was full, they drew it ashore, sat down, and put the good into baskets, but threw out the bad. So it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all this? They answered, yes. And he said to them, therefore, every scribe who has been trained for the kingdom of heaven is like the master of a household who brings out of his treasure what is new and what is old. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Every living thing starts out small. Whether it be the mighty sequoia or the little violet plant, whether it be an elephant, a human being, or a mouse, everything starts out from something rather small. A seed, a sperm and an egg, some little tiny incident in which exists all of the code that determines what that particular thing is going to be. Mouse becomes mouse, elephant elephant, human human, tree tree. And even within that seed, there is the reality of what we will turn out like. Our hair color, our height, some of our body shape, perhaps even what kind of diseases we might suffer from. It's all right there in that tiny, tiny mark, in that tiny, tiny mark that seems almost impossible if you think about it. Small to big, that's how living things work. But it's also how movements work. Generally, movements don't start with huge numbers of people, but just a few, maybe even one person who has a vision, who has an idea, who gets caught up in something that says, this is so important, I need to champion the cause. And I'm just hoping that other people will come along beside me. If you remember anything from your history world, it was names of people. Usually people that were remembered because they were initiators or instigators. The kind of people that made a difference simply by working diligently at the areas they felt were significant. In the religious world, we of course remember Luther and Calvin and Zwingli, who started the Reform movement in the Reformation era. We might consider our own founding fathers who worked diligently because they felt that freedom from England was something that was significant. And were willing to do things that we today say, I don't think we should do that, but thought that was the way it would work. Or I think of women like Harriet Tubman, who helped slaves to freedom, or Rosa Parks, who chose not to get off a seat on the bus. Or the women who started the movement for women's rights. Two women in a little town in upstate New York who said, you know what? I think women should have the right to vote. So Susan B. Anthony and Elizabeth Cady Stanton just pushed and pushed and pushed until finally it got through. One person driving the bus, moving people forward so that their vision becomes a grabbing tool in
a reality for many.
Even now, I come to understand there are these individuals who somehow have the charism to drive movements forward. And we are thrilled to see them put into practice that which they believe. Jesus tells these parables, five here, of a variety of things. But what struck me about the first couple is this notion of smallness to greatness, insignificance to the very thing that matters for many. Seed, a yeast, a pearl, a treasure. Nothing that we would initially look at and say, oh, that's going to make the difference. But somehow planted, that becomes a bush. And somehow infused in the flower, turns it into bread. Somehow these little things begin to grow and expand and make an impact far greater than what today's look like to start with. The kingdom of God is like that, says Jesus. We have to say he's probably right. Because if anyone had told the followers of Jesus that this peasant from Nazareth would become the founder or the base for the world's largest religious community, people would have thought they were nuts. And yet that's what happened. Jesus enters into human history, is planted by God, and from him, those disciples take that growth and begin to move out and out and out. And the ripple effect lasts and lasts and lasts. And even there, those disciples went one at a time, maybe two at a time, to places to share the story, and new people came on board. And over time, more people went places. And pretty much every church in Europe can think about the initial person who came and brought the gospel. Augustine to England, Boniface to Germany, Cyril and Methodius off to Russia. They tell those stories because there was one small one who made a difference in the lives of thousands. And perhaps we too might be seen as insignificant. Yet our lives, our work, our actions, our outreach to others makes a difference even when we aren't always certain. Even when we don't know what the impact will be, there is an impact on the things we do in the lives of others. Many things start small. Many things start with one person. But from that one, great things happen. God gives us the wisdom to discern how we can make the most with what we have so the blessings may be shared among mustard seed or yeast.